Good morning and welcome to the Santa Cruz Seventh-day Adventist Lovers of Jesus Church. Amen. Had to add that little thing on there because I'm looking at your faces. That's what you're telling me. You're here because you love Jesus. I know I am here for that same reason. We have a special treat today. We have a visiting pastor, as you can see, and our hearts are going to be filled with the gift that he's going to give us today. Give you a little bio on this gentleman, our brother, Pastor Daniel Govia, was born and raised in a small European country called Portugal. He studied theology in France and Spain. Having completed a Doctor of Ministry with Andrews University, after working for 11 years as pastor with the Portuguese Union, in August 2015, he accepted a call from the Central California Conference to serve as the senior pastor of the Fresno Hispanic Seventh-day Adventist Lovers of Jesus Church. Pastor Daniel is married to Dr. Cilian Govia, and the couple has a seven-year-old son named Lucas. And I bet God is coming to them through Lucas. I have that feeling because he came to me through my children. He taught me so much. So it sounds like Lucas is going to be raising them into understanding more about God. Anyway, I would also like to say on your bulletin, if you open it up, upcoming events, there's so many good plugs here. Oh, we don't have a whole lot of time for all of them, but I'm going to mention the whole food plant-based get-together that's coming up. Look at that and think of Genesis 1:29. It's God's message for us and how to fuel his temple. Your body is actually his temple. It is, yeah. And Galatians 2:20 is the way to fulfill that. So you've got God's will. Now you've got God's will power. Not just his will, but his will power. Genesis 1:20, add Galatians 2:20 to that, Genesis 1:29, and you'll eat different. God will do it for you. He'll open your mouth and put the fork and the spoon in there and put the right things in there. Just let him do it. Anyway, there's other plugs. VHM's having a skate night. Look at that. Read those. I'll save time by just saying, read those upcoming events. Let's be part of this church family and let God love each other through us because that's really the gospel message. So at this time, we're going to have our offering. If the deacons will please bless us to come up for that. Overflow offering is for the local church budget. Of course, there's the tithe, and we know it's 10%, but God swells your heart and can make it 15%, and not on the net, but on the gross. God's done that in my life, and let me tell you, he just continues to bless, either with health or finances or spiritual things or physical things, all kinds of things. He has no limit to how he can bless us. So let's have just a short prayer before we take up the offering. Loving Father, you're beyond anything we ever hoped for or dreamed of. You're that master that came and bought us when the slaves were being sold, and you took us home. And you gave us a house. And you gave us room in your house, actually. But you gave us a house and you gave us land. And you said, you're free to do with it what you want. You're not my slave. You're my son. Or you're my daughter. And so, Father, we return to you right now. All that you've given us. We're just a mere echo of what you're doing for us. Amen. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Let's stand together as we sing our hymn 214 in your hymnal, if you would like to turn there. We have this hope. Wonderful, like you all believe it. Have a seat.
So at this time, we're going to have the Lamb's offering. Our children's story will be told by our brother Isaiah Black. Praise the Lord. He's back with his lovely wife, his better 99%. I said it right. Anyway, the lambs will get their buckets and come forward, and we get that opportunity again to let go of that sticky stuff called money. And sometimes we get it wrong. We put our trust in it instead of the God that provides it and gives it to us. And it's His money. Come on. All of it's His. So let's only give as much as you love, okay? Only give as much as you love the Lord. How's that? Boy, that slays me. I'm shredded.
Okay, let's all grab a seat. How many of you guys know what this is? It's an iPad. iPad mini, nice. Is it weird that I have an iPad mini instead of a regular iPad?
No.
Yeah. Yeah, they are comfortable. Good call. Excellent call. Well, how many of you guys have ever had somebody say, "You're weird"? Anyone tells you you're weird? People tell me it all the time, and they used to tell it to me all the time. And we're going to look at some things that happen around the world that we might think is a little weird, okay? So, let's start. How many of you guys have ever lost a tooth? Lost tooth? Sorry, you guys might not relate to this one. You're a little. You lost a tooth yesterday? Well, what do you do when you lose your teeth? Anyone?
Put on your pet.
You give it to the tooth fairy.
Okay.
Put it under your pillow and you have money.
Put it in a bag so it won't get lost.
Okay, how about, and there's gonna be chances for everyone else too. How about, do any of you guys ever throw your tooth on the roof? You never threw your tooth on a roof? Well, in Greece, little kids, they throw their teeth on the roof because they think it's gonna make them grow strong and healthy. Is that weird? Okay, how about this one? What are those things called? Bracelets, right? Now, do you put your bracelets on your neck or on your wrist?
Wrist.
How about when you put something like that on your neck and grow your neck super long? Is that weird? Look how long her neck is. Okay, how many of you guys know what that is?
Snail.
It's a snail. Now, when you think of snails, do you think like, lunch? Well, this person does. Is that weird or what? How about this one? What's that?
Cricket
or grasshopper? Now, when you see that, you go, dinner.
No.
Well, this person does. Ew. Is that weird or what? Okay, what's all that stuff? You guys might be very familiar with that now. That's mud, right? Now, does mud make you clean or does it make you dirty? Dirty. So you probably don't want to take a bath in mud, do you?
No.
Well, those people are taking a bath in mud. What? Isn't that weird? Okay, how about this one? What happened to him? It looks like he scraped his elbow. What's that stuff on his elbow?
Blood.
It's blood, huh? That's all in our bodies and everything. Now, when you have blood on you, do you usually wash your clothes in blood?
No,
you use like laundry detergent and water, right? Well, guess what? Whenever we do anything that's bad, it's called a sin. And that's not good. That's really not something that's gonna lead to life. And we need to be washed by the blood of Jesus. So that's totally weird because Jesus' blood, how's that wash us? It's because he died on the cross for us to take away all our bad things that we do. And all we have to do is say, Jesus, will you please take away my bad things? And he'll do it for you. And he'll wash you clean of all your sins, okay?
Amen.
And he loves you. So next time somebody says, you're weird, I'm gonna give you guys a little bit of advice. If somebody says, you're weird, all you gotta say is, I'm not weird, I'm just limited edition. Okay, go ahead and go back to your seats and your parents will tell you what that means.
Thank you.
Is it on?
Yes.
I don't think so.
Commune with me.
O kind, loving Heavenly Father, our dear progenitor, our creator, the lover of our souls, we pray for all the people to come to know you better and for you to manifest yourself in us and through us. The people that are here, their families, their in-laws, their outlaws, everybody. Our enemies, love our enemies through us, Father. Change our judging and our criticism into praying for their salvation, that they become lovers of Jesus too, to let them know that they're much better people than how they're acting at any certain time. And Father, be with those that aren't here today. Touch them in a very special way, a very spiritual way that you can only do. It's your way, is the way of the Holy Spirit. And oh, Father, continue with us. Do for us what we are so reluctant to do for you and to do for ourselves and others. Live your life in us and through us, Father. Give us your emotions, your imagination, your thoughts, your attitude, your personality, your character. And Father, keep us abiding. Rather than us trying to abide in you, we choose for you to abide in us.
Amen.
It's your strength, Father, not ours. Amen. And in all this, we say, bless you, Father, that you be blessed on this Sabbath day, mm-hmm. because you bless us so much. It's beyond our imagination, but we do thank you and love you in whatever little, small, finite way we can. You accept us in the Beloved. So it's when you look at us, you think of Jesus. When you look at Jesus, you think of us. You're that great. We love you, Father. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
They got me on double duty today.
Amen.
Amen. Reminds me of old times, right? Good to see everybody. Well, actually, I can see you better now. All the way in the back. Hi. Hi. On that side, too. Hi. So, how's life in Santa Cruz these days? You guys are making, I live in Portland now, and you guys are making Portland weather look kind of weak. It's amazing, you know, it's amazing though, because this rain always makes me think of the latter rain of the Holy Spirit in our lives, because he's coming soon, Jesus is coming soon, and we want to be ready, we want to be surrendered, we want to be prepared for his soon coming, and we need his faith. We can't have our own faith, we can't have our own doings, we need him. So this song is called The Faith of Our Father.
gate of Babylon, we must carry on till he comes again. Count it all a joy when the trials come to destroy the peace you have within. Testing faith makes patience of the saints that comes through.
Wow. Okay. A troubadour for the Lord. Thank you. There's a tree of life in heaven, and God picked a plum. Her name is Hattie Plum. And he sent her to us. And she's going to read the scripture, because a child shall lead them.
Today's scripture will be Matthew 24:37. When the Son of Man comes, it will be as went happened during Noah's time. Matthew 24:37.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Thank you. That was awesome. You know, when I was considering to leave my country and come to the United States, I was kind of suffering because my wife wanted to come. I wanted to come, but I didn't want to come because in Portugal, everybody invited me to preach everywhere. I had to say no to a lot of invitations because the whole country knew me. And I was thinking, I'm going to the United States. I'm going to lose my reputation. And I was praying beside my bed one night, and I opened the Bible to Philippians chapter 2, you know. I think Isaiah was inspired by that verse too. It says, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, that being in the likeness of God, in the form of God, did not consider it robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation. So it was like God telling me, I lost my reputation for you. Wouldn't you be willing to lose your reputation for your wife? Because my wife needed a warm and dry climate. And California used to be warm and dry. I don't know what happened. I think I brought some blessings from Portugal because it's raining a lot. But I thank God because after 1 year and a half, now I'm to the point of, again, I have to say no to some invitations. But when I met Wanda, I couldn't say no to her because, you know, we're kind of related. You look at her, you look at me, you know we have the same father. We have the faith of our father, and our father has given us the same gift, okay? We have what many, many people told me that they would like to have. All right? You look at me and you look at Wanda, you know we have a special gift. We can eat whatever we want, whenever we want it, and we don't get additional weight. God is good or what? Well, to me, he's very good, okay? Praise the Lord. So, Wanda, thank you for your invitation. I know you have an awesome pastor in this church. I have visited with him just once or twice, and I've noticed that he is one of the good ones. Amen. Pastor Thomas Gardner, I want to praise God for him because he still believes the Bible message and the way that Seventh-day Adventists for long have believed what are the essential truths for this time. So praise the Lord for him. I think you are blessed. And after coming to your church just for a few minutes, I understood that you are blessed also with the people that you have here. So praise the Lord. Praise God. And I ask that God may bless you this morning through his word. You know, the messenger is not really important. The word of God and the message, that is very important. We have a small town called Santa Cruz in Portugal. Did you know? A small town. And it's also by the sea, the Atlantic, not the Pacific. But it's cold like you have here, you know. It's very cold. And that sea, that Atlantic Ocean, and especially there near Santa Cruz, the waves are very big and very dangerous. You probably heard about Nazaré, where that guy broke the record with a big, big wave and a big surfboard. And that's really close by Santa Cruz. The sea there is very, very, very dangerous. The waves are very big. And today I want to share about a time where water is a blessing, right? It's coming down from heaven. We all wanted water, but now when we get too much water, sometimes it's not a blessing, right? Dams start to be broken and people have to flee from their homes. We're living that here in California. And actually, the world saw that once in a very dramatic way, when God said enough. We're going to read today in Genesis chapter 6. I invite you to just bow your heads with me as we pray before we read God's word. Dear Father in heaven, we are so happy that we can worship you freely. We believe that soon our freedoms will be taken away. But we thank you for each moment of peace, each moment that we can come together and worship you as a family. I thank you for giving me the opportunity of knowing this part of the body of Jesus Christ here in Santa Cruz. And I pray that your Holy Spirit may speak to them and that you may use these lips and this heart of dust so that your perfect word, your powerful word, may transform people's hearts and lives today. That's what we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Genesis chapter 6. Like our young friend and sister read, as in the days of Noah were, so also will the coming of the Son of Man be. And let's read about those days, the days of Noah, in Genesis chapter 6. Genesis chapter 6, verse 1, and we will continue to read a few verses. Genesis chapter 6, starting at verse 1. Now it came to pass, when men began to multiply on the face of the earth, and daughters were born to them, that the sons of God saw the daughters of men, that they were beautiful, and they took wives for themselves of all whom they chose. And the Lord said, my spirit shall not strive with man forever, for he is indeed flesh, yet his days shall be 120 years. There were giants on the earth in those days, and also afterward, when the sons of God came in to the daughters of men, and they bore children to them, those were the mighty men who were of old, men of renown. Then the Lord saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every intent of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. And the Lord was sorry that he had made man on the earth, and he was grieved in his heart. So the Lord said, I will destroy man whom I have created from the face of the earth, both man and beast, creeping thing and birds of the air, for I am sorry that I have made them. But Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. You know, there was a moment in time where God said, enough. Let's try together to answer two questions today. Why did God say enough? And why did God save Noah? Of all people, why did God save Noah and his family? Why did God say enough? Well, first, because of the moral decline among his own people. Who were the sons of God in this story? Who were the sons of God? See, the Bible says, Genesis 6, that there were men, the daughters of men, and there were the sons of God. Who are the sons of God? Well, if you read the preceding chapter, right, you see in chapter 5, talking about the genealogy of Adam. This is the book, chapter 5, verse 1. This is the book of the genealogy of Adam. In the day that God created man, he made him in the likeness of God. He created them male and female and blessed them and called them mankind. In the day they were created. And Adam lived 130 years and begot a son in his own likeness after his image, and he named him Seth. See? Very interesting. God made man as at his image and likeness. Man was kind of a son of God, right? Of course, he lost that because he became a sinner. He was no longer a son of God. Now he was only a man. But redeemed by grace, when Seth started to call upon the name of the Lord, we know that, right? There were two lines of descendants of Adam. Cain, they did not call upon God. They were very good with technology. They lived in the plain, and they were very good with many things concerning this earth and life on this earth. And there was Seth. and the descendants of Seth who were calling on the name of God, living in the mountains, maybe not very good with technology and with the science of this world, but very good in spiritual life. And they wanted the kingdom of God to come back, and they wanted to be sons and daughters of God, and they were the sons of God. God considered them sons. God looks at people who have the grace of God in their hearts, people who accept Jesus as their personal Savior, and God looks at them and calls them sons and daughters. Those who received him gave him the power of being children of God, right? But to people who do not worship him and who do not accept his grace, he is respectful and he calls them what they are, men and women. Now look at this. Amazing. The sons of God who wanted the kingdom of God, who looked to God, who called upon God, one day they saw beautiful women passing by. I don't know how they came to the mountains, or maybe they came down to buy some food. I don't know. And their hearts became divided, okay, between God and the spiritual kingdom and the pleasures of this world. They were so beautiful, and they start falling in love with women that would eventually draw their hearts away from God. Moral decline among his own people. Divided hearts, lukewarm hearts. Ooh, interesting, right? Because you look at the story of Christianity in Revelation chapter 2 and 3, and you see that the last church, the last Christians living upon earth, they will be suffering moral decline. They are lukewarm. They think they are rich, but they are wretched, right? And when the church, when Christianity starts losing its love for God above all things, when people start loving the pleasures of this life and of flesh more than God, then it is time for God to say, enough, enough. I can't deal with this anymore. I can't deal with divided hearts. You know, I'm going to tell you a story. I probably shouldn't tell this, but I'm going to tell you anyways. I love my wife. I am happily married. I want to state this up front, okay? Very happily married. God is good. I praise God every day for my wife. But before I knew my wife, I was searching for the daughters of men, you know? Unfortunately, actually, daughters of men. And I was probably also a man, right? And what happened was that one night I was in the theater. I was about 18 or 19 years of age. I can't say it exactly, but it was one of many unfruitful relationships. And I was in love with a girl that had been in love with me. And while she was in love with me, I didn't want her for nothing. And when I became in love with her, of course, I don't want you. But we went to the theater together. It was a great, great theater play. And we were looking at it, and she was coughing and coughing and coughing. And I said, look, you need to take some lemon with honey. And she said, I don't need lemon with honey because I'm sweet as honey. And I said, I don't know. I never tasted you. Don't do this at home, okay? And don't do this in the theater. Don't do this anywhere. I'm not telling you how you should live. I was in a divided state of heart and mind back then, okay? I came to the church on the Sabbath. I don't know if there's anyone here like me. I did that, you know. I went to the clubs on Friday night and then to the church on Saturday morning, right? And we smiled to everyone and said, hello. And we have our suits and ties. Well, not back then. And that day I went home and I was, you know, the divided hearts. It's hard to live with a divided heart because you feel it. You feel it. That relationship is not good for you, Daniel. It's like, ah! So I went to my bed and I opened my Bible. You know, I had this kind of relationship with God. You there, me here. When I need you, I call you, okay? So I needed him, so I said, okay, I'm going to call you today. Come on, you want to tell me anything? I mean, I feel that I'm falling in love with this girl, and she was in love with me. I didn't want anything to do with her, and now she probably won't want anything to do with me. I know that, well, she is not a daughter of God, right? And she has a terrible life, but I don't know. What do you think? And, you know, God is so good and merciful that he even talks to divided hearts. And God talked to me that night. Don't try to do this every time you read the Bible, because it won't work every time. But sometimes it works. Sometimes God is so desperate to get your attention and to deliver you from suffering that he will talk to you very, very directly. And I opened my Bible to Proverbs chapter 5. This is the truth, okay? It will sound awkward, weird, but it is the truth. I opened my Bible to Proverbs chapter 5. Never read it before, but when I was 18, I read it the first time. My son, pay attention to my wisdom. Lend your ear to my understanding, that you may preserve discretion and your lips may keep knowledge. For the lips of the immoral woman drip honey, and her mouth is smoother than oil. But in the end, she is bitter as wormwood, sharp as a two-edged sword. Her feet go down to death. Her steps lay hold of hell. Dear little Daniel, you want to go to hell? You don't, right? So keep away from that woman who has the lips as honey, but she is, You know what I did, right? What do you think I did? Divided hearts, the daughters of men are beautiful. Like a little dog, I would do whatever she wanted me to do. Super in love for 9 months, and then it was a flood of tears. She did something so bad to me. I never cried so much in my whole life. But that day I saw a rainbow, because God is very merciful. God is very merciful. So, dear friend, if you are tempted today to unite your life, I see some people here that probably are not married, some children and young people. If you are tempted to unite your life, your heart, your mind, your soul to a person or an organization that will drive you away from God, think twice, please. Think twice. God is trying to tell you, please, please, I want to deliver you from a flood of tears. Do not be unequally yoked, said Paul in 2 Corinthians, together with unbelievers. For what fellowship has righteousness with lawlessness? And what communion has light with darkness? And what accord has Christ with Belial? Or what part has a believer with an unbeliever? And what agreement has the temple of God? If you are a temple of God, if you have the Spirit of God dwelling in you, please think twice before you unite yourself to a person that in the temple, in the throne of his or her heart, does not have God in the first place. If you gave your life to Jesus and you were already united to a person like that, just love that person. Love that person with all the Holy Spirit that you have in your heart. Amen? But if you have to choose, if you have the choice, please mind your ways, because you have to love God more than any woman or any man. Amen? God said enough because of the moral decline among his people. God said enough because of another thing. Look at verse 4. There were giants on the earth in those days. Why did Noah have to speak about those giants right before he spoke about the flood? Of course, I think that Noah wanted us to know that men back then and women were not like prehistoric beasts, okay? They were higher, they were stronger, they were more intelligent, they lived longer, and they probably looked better. Better than me, for sure. You know, when I was 15, I went to the gym. My idol was Arnold Schwarzenegger. I thought I would be like him one day. Well, one thing is true. I am an alien, and I live in California. So that's pretty close. That's as close as I can get. Because 1 year pumping iron, and I couldn't do it. Maybe I should continue, of course, more years. But I couldn't. But you know what? You know what? Look at how the New Living Translation translates Genesis 6:4. In those days, and for some time after, giant Nephilites lived on the earth. For whenever the sons of God had intercourse with women, they gave birth to children who became the heroes, the heroes and famous warriors of ancient times. God said enough. When men and women, when human beings started to worship another human beings, stars. Oh, you have Hollywood in the California, right? Stars. We want to look like them. We want to be like them. We want to live like them. But, oh, friend, they don't live like God wants. I'm sorry. The majority of them, not all of them, praise God. But the majority of them, they don't live like God wants us to live. They're sons of men. They're not sons of God. And you know, Satan uses influential people, intelligent people, smart people, beautiful people, famous people, heroes, okay? Even religious heroes. You know, the Bible says, and you know that, I'm sure you know that, you're Seventh-day Adventists. 2 Thessalonians 2, 3 and 4, let no one deceive you by any means, for that day will not come unless the falling away comes first, and the man of sin is revealed, the son of perdition, who opposes and exalts himself above all that is called God or that is worshipped, so that he sits as God in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. You know, I was looking at a program on the Vatican, and the strategy that bishops and cardinals use today to promote Catholicism is to make of the Pope a superstar. They acknowledge it. I'm not telling something that they don't acknowledge, okay? They make it a superstar because people love superstars. People love to follow men, but there's only one man you have to follow, Jesus Christ. He is the God-man whom you should have as the hero of your life, the hero of your heart, the love of your heart, the greatest love of your heart. Because when God saw that men were putting men, that women were putting women in the place that only God should dwell, God said, enough, enough. And God said enough because they committed the sin that you should never commit. There's an unpardonable sin in the Bible, right? The sin against the Holy Spirit. Look, you know, in verse 3 says, and the Lord said, my spirit shall not strive with man forever. And of course, we believe that the Holy Spirit was struggling, was actually fighting to win the hearts of men and women back to God. But also, this word strive can be translated by abide. My spirit shall not live in humanity forever. Since they want other gods dwelling in their temples, I cannot be there anymore. And because of that, God had to say, enough. You know, when you persist and persist and persist to do your own will against the will of God, you put your own voice in the place that you should have only the voice of God. Remember that Jesus said, blasphemy against the Holy Spirit cannot be forgiven? Blasphemy is interpreted as a human being taking the position of God, okay? When you think and when you reason and when you give a place to your thoughts and reasonings and your will that is above the Word of God, you are blaspheming against the Holy Spirit. You are putting the voice of the Holy Spirit away to listen to your own voice. And be careful, friends, because I hear a lot of people today saying, oh, God told me this, God told me that, God told me, whoa, man, that's incredible. I would like to have that relationship with God. God is always speaking to you, and you hear him so out loud. That's amazing. But you know what? I think that Jesus taught us, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. Okay, God talk to you, great. But please, please, be sure that what he told you is according to the word of God, all right? Because he will not contradict himself. So let's live by the principles of the word of God. And God said enough also because they became not similar to God. They lost the likeness and image of God, and they became like the devil. Have you noticed in the text? It says, verse 5, "Then the Lord saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every intent of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually." God is love. God is always trying to bless, always trying to save, always trying to love you and to save you and to renew you and to bless you. But Satan is the contrary, right? Look at this. Verses 9 to 13 says, "This is the genealogy of Noah. Noah was a just man, perfect in his generations. Noah walked with God." Actually, there's a version, New Living Translation says, "Noah walked in a close fellowship with God." What a beautiful thing, right? It says, "And Noah begot three sons, Shem, Ham, and Japheth. The earth also was corrupt before God, and the earth was filled with" what? "Violence." Filled with violence. And it repeats, look, if you come down to verse 13, it repeats that same expression. "And God said to Noah," verse 13, "the end of all flesh has come before me, for the earth is filled with violence through them. And behold, I will destroy them with the earth." They were filled with violence. And you know, this expression rings a bell, right? Filled with violence. Ezekiel chapter 28, verse 16, talking about that covering cherub. You sinned. You became filled with violence within. That's what happens when you stop listening to the voice of the Spirit of God, when you start following your own ways instead of the ways of the Word of God. When you want to become only a man and not a son of God or a daughter of God, you lose the ability of listening to the Holy Spirit. And instead of becoming like the one who created you, you become like the one who tempts you, filled with violence. See, if you would look to Lucifer in heaven, even after the rebellion started in his heart, you would see an angel of light, because he is an angel of light. He is powerful and beautiful. Make no mistakes. He is going to try to get you with beautiful things, with things that apparently are very good. He is beautiful and powerful, but within, he is filled with violence. And the earth became externally what Satan had internally. The earth became filled with violence. Nobody respected life. Life had no value. They started to destroy one another, human beings, and they started to destroy animals. Oh, they started to destroy animals in a large scale. Where are we today? And sometimes just for pleasure, for the fun of it. And because of that, God said, enough. Enough, I can't deal with this anymore. A perverted morality, moral decline among his people, and sin against the Holy Spirit, putting men where God should be, and finally, becoming like the devil, God said, enough. For their own sake, to save them from themselves and from the devil, I have to say, enough. But God saved Noah, and God saved Noah's family. Amen? Let's look at the bright side of the story now for a moment. Why did God save Noah, and why did God save his family? Well, you know, I don't think that we can say Noah deserved it, you know, because the Bible says Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. And grace is an unmerited favor. You can't deserve grace. It's grace. But there were some things about this man who accepted the grace of God, who embraced the grace of God, because God gives grace to everyone. Jesus died for everyone in the cross. But not everyone accepts his grace. Not everyone lets the grace of God transform their hearts. So, about this man, Noah, he had a few characteristics. First, he was morally very sound. You know, God chose him, just one man, to preach the gospel to all the world. Is that true or not? I mean, he was the only prophet of God in a world that was corrupt, and God chose him to proclaim that message throughout the whole world. Of course, he was there. He was doing his ark. They had no, maybe they had no video. I don't know. But all the people came. I mean, look at this crazy dude. Look at this crazy guy. Never a drop came from heaven. He is building an ark in dry land. He obviously doesn't know anything about sea, about the sea. He's not a man of the sea. How is he doing this? And he's preaching that the world is going to be destroyed with a flood. That's terrible. He was the messenger of God to the whole world. The whole world was coming. He had to preach to them, but he never forgot that he had to preach first in his own house. Hebrews chapter 7, verse 11. Remember? Hebrews chapter 7, verse 11. I'm going to read from the New International Version. It says, "By faith, Noah, when warned about things not yet seen, in holy fear, built on an ark to save his family." To save his family. You know, you have to preach the everlasting gospel in all the world. Don't look at me like if I'm the only one that God has today. I am not. The pastors are not. God has chosen you. You, a child, a young person, an adult, an elderly person, you have been given the responsibility of preaching the everlasting gospel to the whole world. Amen? The three angels' messages. You have been given that responsibility, and you should do it with all your heart. You should pray and work and do the best that you can to save your co-workers, your brothers and sisters at church, the visitors at the church, all the people around you. You should do whatever you can and whatever you can to save them, but don't forget that God has given you a family, and family comes first. You preach to your family first, and you preach not really with words. In the family, words are important, but they're not everything. Influence, example, character. When the doors are shut and when I speak alone with my wife, that's when my character is revealed. When I'm tired because I had a hard day, smiling at everybody, and then my son comes and he says, "I had another sit time today." Why? I was talking. Again? I mean, I don't know. He takes after me. Maybe he likes to talk. By the way, I hope I'm still in the time. He likes to talk. He loves to talk. And he's always talking, so the teacher has to be. And when I'm stressed, when I'm tired, that's when my patience is tested. That's when my character is revealed. Ellen G. White wrote something interesting about Noah. It says, Patriarchs and Prophets, chapter 98. Noah's warnings had been rejected by the world, but his influence and example resulted in blessings to his family. As a reward for his faithfulness and integrity, God saved all the members of his family with him. What encouragement! Oh, I'm going to read that again. What encouragement to parental fidelity. Be faithful in your family. Love your family. Be an influence in your family. Preach to your family first. Use words if you have to, but preach with your example, with your love, with your character. Do everything you can. I have a sister who is not, well, she is making her way back to God. Praise the Lord. She is making her way back to God after many suffering, after a flood of suffering. She is making her way back to God. I prayed for her. I prayed and I prayed and I prayed. And I continue to pray Do all that you can. Pray all that you can. Love all that you can. Do everything you can, and God will do what you cannot do. God did for Noah what he couldn't do. Noah lived a morally upright life. God told him, marry one woman, Noah. You know, one of the sins of the antediluvians was that polygamy started being a famous thing. With Lamech, remember? Lamech, polygamy and violence in the same man. And God told Noah, Noah, marry one woman and be faithful to her. And he was for hundreds of years. You can say, how can I be faithful to the same woman all my life? And you're only going to live 70 or 80 or 90. Noah lived hundreds of years, and he was faithful to that woman. Be faithful to your family. Be morally upright in a generation that is not upright today. Oh, friend, Noah had certain characteristics that you and me, we can have if we accept the grace of God to change us. He walked with God in a close fellowship with God. And you know what? The Bible says in Amos 3:3, can two walk together if they are not agreed? Why did he walk in such a close fellowship with God? Because God told him, Noah, educate your sons to my kingdom. Noah, love me more than the heroes of your age. They are saying that it is impossible for a flood of water to come. They are saying that I would not transgress the laws that I have set in place myself, but I made the laws of the nature. I can do whatever I want with them. Just put me first. And God and Noah put God and the words of God first. He listened to God more than he listened to human science and philosophy. While Noah was, Patriarchs and Prophets, page 95, while Noah was giving his warning message to the world, his works testified of his sincerity. It was thus that his faith was perfected and made evident. He gave the world an example of believing just what God says. All that he possessed, look at this. Now you know, this is where you will see if your faith is truly real and sound. All that he possessed, he invested in the ark. Oh, when it touches your wallet, that's when we see how your faith is, what your faith is made of. He invested all that he possessed into the ark. I'm not saying that you should not have a retirement plan, okay? And I'm going to say this out loud again. Please take care of your retirement. If you don't take care of it, the government won't take care of it for you. Take care of your retirement. I've seen many people, I'm only in this country for 1 year and a half, and I've seen many people suffering, struggling, because they didn't thought ahead. So save money, okay? But, seek God first. Those who honor me, I will honor them. He invested all that he possessed. That's how his faith was in the word of God, more than the word of men. Amen? And also, Noah, he was similar. He became, by the grace of God, he became similar to Christ. Look at this. Because of Noah's faithfulness to God, the humanity was saved for this life. Because of Jesus' faithfulness to God, humanity was saved to eternal life. Amen? Because of Noah's righteousness, the Bible says, I have seen that you are righteous before me in this generation. Because of his righteousness, his family was saved. Because of Christ's righteousness, you and me, we can be sons and daughters of God, and we can be saved. Amen? Noah was in a flood of water inside a wooden boat. And after that flood of water, he came out and he brought his family with him to a new world. To save you and me, Jesus came to a wooden cross. He was in a flood of fire in advance for you and me. He went through the flood of fire in advance to come out of there and bring the captives free, free from death, because he overcame death for you and me. Jesus, in the last flood of fire, will be circumscribed to walls of gold with you and me if we accept his grace and we are faithful until the end. Be faithful until death, I will give you the crown of life. When the flood of fire will be destroying the wicked and will be destroying Satan and his angels. In that place, Jesus with his family, preserved by the angels of God, he will be with us, and he will come forth, not to a destroyed world, not to a world that was much worse than the original. He will come forth to a world that is much better than the original. Beautiful. No pain. No violence. No immorality. No hearts that are divided. No floods of tears. Jesus will come forth with his family from all races, all nations, all peoples, all tongues. And he will live with us forever. Because Jesus had a difference concerning his life and the life of Noah. Noah didn't die in the flood. Jesus died for you and me on that cross. He went through that hell of fire for you and me. So that today, when you look up, you can see a rainbow around his throne. Remember, Ezekiel and Revelation say that there is a rainbow around the throne of God. And how are rainbows made? Well, the light, normally the light of the sun, enters drops of water. Many drops of water, not just one, many. And the light is reflected, refracted, and dispersed. And it becomes a beautiful, beautiful sight. See, when you come to the throne of God, when you come boldly, knowing that Jesus is interceding for you, and you expose your life, even if you have a divided heart, just come as you are. And you come to the throne of grace. And you know that there is still mercy. God has not said enough yet. You can still say, God, here I am. Create in me a clean heart, O God. The light of the Son of Righteousness will enter. The light of the Son of Righteousness will not only be reflected, but you will share it in your own special way. You will refract it, and you will disperse it, and the sight will be glorious, and the glory will be to God. Dear friends and family, we arrived to the days of Noah again. God is about to say enough. But today I want to say, God, here I am. Please renew my heart. Please give me the faith of Noah. Give me the faith of Jesus. I want to say this to God today, so I'm going to respond to my own appeal first. And if you want to respond to it, please stand with me and let's pray. Dear Father in heaven, we thank you because out of mercy, out of love, you said one day enough. And out of mercy, out of love, you will say again enough. But Lord, thank you because today we can come. And we can come just as we are. And we can ask you to give us the faith of Noah, the faith of your Son, Jesus Christ, that was willing to suffer the flood of hell, hellfire, to save me and every person listening to these words. Thank you, Jesus. for dying for us on that flood, on that cross, where the sins of the whole world were placed upon you. And out of love for me, out of love for each and every person that is here, you did what nobody else could do, nobody else ever did or will ever do. You are our only way, our only hope. Lord, please, you have given Noah the grace of loving you back. Give us that grace today also. May we live morally upright lives by your grace. May we look to you instead of looking unto men. May we walk in a close fellowship with you, listening and obeying to the voice of the Holy Spirit. And may we present a sacrifice that is holy and acceptable to you, because it is covered with the sacrifice of Christ. It's what we pray in his holy name. Amen.
You may turn in your hymnals if you would like to number 608 as we sing Faith is the Victory.
God in your midst, the Holy One will save. He will rejoice over you with gladness. He will quiet you with his love. He will rejoice over you with singing. God, may that day come soon when you will say enough. Enough of this separation. I love my children, and I am going to get them, and I'm going to be with them forever. Until that day, bless us, we pray, that your light may be reflected through our lives. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen.